Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Karel de Waal. I'm here from the dealing desk at PSG Wealth Bryanston. I'm a junior trader now, and hopefully I'll be able to give you some quite a educational and informative information today about how to build a long-term profitable share portfolio using dividends as your key driver to beat inflation. To start off, I got a nice quote here that I want to share with you guys. Just there we go. Okay. Quote says, the stock market is a wonderfully efficient mechanism for transferring wealth from an impatient to the patient. This is a quote by Warren Buffett that I quite find very, very attractive for me within the investment field. And like I said, he's a guy that one can look up to within this environment. And we're transitioning here from here to our contents. What we're going to cover today will be firstly, how to design your share portfolio. Secondly, how we're going to take action. How we're going to make these investments. And thirdly, how to maintain them and how to review thereafter. So to start, we will go and move on to part one of this webinar. And there we go. Okay, the first slide says designing your share portfolio, how to know what you are as an investor willing to invest in. What's important here that in today's financial marketplace, a well-maintained share portfolio is vital to the success of an individual investor. Therefore, I believe that it is critically important to find the perfect balance between potential risk versus the potential rewards that you can get from these investments. Some would say that there are two basic questions that you've got to ask yourself here: is how much time do I have, and then what are my financial investment goals? Secondly, some important factors I would like you to note on here is you got to think about what age are you? Are you an investor aged 20 to 25, or say by the 60 to 65? That brings up quite a timing constraint for you about how much money you can actually make during that time. Also, secondly, you can look at what are the amounts available for me to invest in the financial markets. Thirdly, you can look at the resources available to me. Fourthly, what are my projected capital needs for the future? Do I have a plan extra this? Do I have current investments currently in the market, like say collective investment schemes, your unit trusts? What else do I have? And then fifthly, what other resources are there for me except using the share financial market to gain success? Moving on, I believe we get two types of investors in the financial markets. You can be either conservative or aggressive. You have to decide which one are you. You got to start to try and see that do you merely want to protect and maintain the value of your investment, and how do you adhere to these risk factors that are in the markets. Thereafter, we get our aggressive investments investors. These are investors that are comfortable with a medium to high degree of risk. You are also able to withstand year-on-year fluctuations within the financial markets and the value of your share portfolio in exchange for potentially further higher long-term returns within the financial markets. Thereafter, the third part of this of the third share of our first part, we will look at how to design our share portfolio. Within that of subdivisions, diversifying your capital between these sectors. What I'd like to say here is that determining which sector to invest in, a shareholder must know that there are quite a lot of sectors within the financial market industries. We get, for example, the main three ones that are listed here for you are resources, industrials, and financials, which I believe are some of the biggest holding sectors in the financial markets now. The second bullet point there would be to look at the market capitalization. What the market capitalization means, it's determined by a multiple by multiplying a given company's outstanding shares by the current price of one share on the market at that time. This will give us a holistic view to see if our share is a large cap, a medium cap share, or a small cap, etc. I will go further into these market caps at a later stage. And then finally, risk. It's important for your shareholder to diversify between these sectors to minimize your risk within the market. So just to take it a step back and summarize what we've just looked at in the first part of my presentation now, is that we saw that we can either be a conservative investor or an aggressive investor, and then to take into account which sectors are available for me to invest in, what's the market cap of these stocks within these sectors, and then also how to diversify and spread the risk out, allocate my funds between these sectors within the financial markets. Okay, to move on to part two of our presentation, this is where I feel like there's more meat on the bone to go into with you. Got to start out just to clarify that mainly we find that we have two share types. The first would be ordinary shares, and the second would be preference shares. Mostly for me, the difference between ordinary and preference shares would be the manner of how they pay dividends. With ordinary shares, companies have a choice on whether the timing, do they want to, depending on their certain situation, where they are during the year on their results and earnings, do they want to share that with you as shareholder? So therefore, they have the choice. With preference shares, companies do not have a choice to pay out dividends. They pay out, they have the obligation to pay out a fixed dividend to you. In the event, another thing to look at, in the event if a company gets liquidated, would you rather be in a position if you have ordinary shares or preference shares? Because preference shares hold preference to ordinary shares in the payout if a company gets liquidated, in the how they distribute the assets back to you as shareholder. Mainly the shares listed on the JSE are all comprised of ordinary shares, but yes, you do get some preference shares within that as well. Just to take on, we're going to give a nice description here of our ordinary shares. Firstly, I would like to look at growth shares. Our growth shares are shares that increase in value faster than that of the rest of the market, based on their prior performance, and they have more risk over time but offer greater potential rewards at the end. These are companies that you can look like they invest in themselves to acquire other parts of companies and expand themselves to be bigger at the end of the day. Secondly, we have income shares. Income shares do not fluctuate that much, but they have a history of paying out better dividends. Income shares can comprise ordinary or preference shares. Thirdly, we have value shares. These are shares that the market usually sees as undervalued. Of course, they can be purchased at a price lower to their underlying worth. But theory is when the market comes to its senses, the owner of such a stock would stand a chance to make a lot of money as they retain their value. And the fourth point there, we have blue chip shares. Blue chips, like your Naspers, these are shares that used to perform well over a long period of time in the market. Those fairly stable investments. And they do not grow as rapidly as the other shares, but they do show steady growth for you, and their steady income over that time as well. Fifthly, defensive shares. These are shares that do not shares in companies whose products and services people buy no matter what the economy is doing at that time. So you don't have such a large economical influence with this. Like I said, with the cyclical shares we're going to get to now. But these include shares like your food and beverages companies and your pharmaceuticals, along with that, your utilities as well. And then in contrast, your cyclical shares, these shares rise and fall as the economy do. And lastly, our speculative shares, our penny stocks, they include offerings for young companies just into the markets, and they are there for people, for investors who's looking for something new, a new way to beat the market, as they are, these shares are very unpredictable and they are, to say, a bit more risky, but they can offer a lot of potential for you as investor as well. So to take into account all of these types of shares that I just mentioned, you can then go take it a step back and go listlessly and see how the JSE is built up. Firstly, we can say the top 40 stocks of the market. These are large caps, like Naspers, BHP, Billiton. All the big guys are in there. Secondly, is your mid caps. That would be below that 200, so your 4,200 shares, and then your smaller caps that falls out of the top 100 shares of the JSE. All of this compromises your all share index. So a nice thing to look at this with another view as well. Just remind you guys that if you feel like I am going a bit fast with this, it's because of I'm covering a very wide topic area here, and I'm not going to be able to go into depth with each of it. But at a later stage, yes, we can, or you can just by email pop me a question, and we want to have further detail or more in-depth knowledge of this, and I will be able to assist you. Okay, so moving on to our next part, we're going to look at how to analyze shares on a fundamental basis. I do believe this is the cornerstone of investing. If you can understand it, how to use fundamentals within your investments, it's quite useful for you to look at this, because you can look at fundamentals takes up an account to a pool of funds, let's say, pull up everything into qualitative and quantitative data. In context, quantitative fundamentals are your more numerical numbers-wise data, so you can look at your financial statements over time. Quantitative fundamentals are there to use to check up how the company's business model is working. Do they have a competitive advantage over their competitors? How their management is structuring, how they're using their money and their corporate governance as well. Qualitative data, there's a more or less tangible, but they offers such things as high quality of the board members and the key executives. Points to point out there are the customers, what's their market share percentage, what's their competition, and how do they appeal to their regulation above them. For me, the main goal of fundamental analysis is to find the intrinsic value of the company, and therefore, it's a quite fancy word for the actual value of a company. Moving on, we can, in making your investments with fundamental analysis, you actually want to answer a few questions to yourself. Firstly, is this company's revenue growing? Is the company actually making a profit? Is the company strong enough to beat out the competitors in the future? How appealing are they to repay their debts? Can they do it over time? And then lastly is to see if management cook. I use the quote there to cooking the books. Basically, where I read this is to see within the analyzing the management comments of the financial statements. When you delve into that, you can actually find out quite a few interesting stuff for yourself to see if they are really accurately giving out their results. And of course, there are hundreds of other key points or questions you can ask yourself, but what it really boils down to is one question: is the company a good investment for you as shareholder? And thereby, what we can use, tools we can use to analyze if we are investing in a good share. What I'm more like is evaluation part of it, where we can use the ratios to see. And the first one I'd like to delve into, the price to earnings ratio. What we can see in the price to earnings ratio is that the ratio is used to for valuing a company that measures its current share price relative to that of a per share earnings. Basically, what it says is the market value of the share, where it's currently trading in the market, dividing that by the earnings per share that they distribute within their results to the market, and thereby we can get a good multiple of how's our share doing relative to that of others in the market. I put it as an example there for you guys to go through. Firstly, we can see if you take up company A, They declared a dividend of 2 rand earnings per share on their latest results. Their closing price on date was 40 rand, meaning if we divide that 40 rand, you see there I just put placed it in cents for you guys. 4,000 cents divided by 200 cents will give us a PE ratio of about 20. I do believe this is quite a good indication if you take that to an average market PE of say between 16 to 20, and you measure it to a relatively cheap PE, say more to 11 to 13, you're quite in a good range of a company that's quite built up strongly there. With the PE ratio as well, you do get sometimes multiples that says above 100, meaning these are shares like your growth stocks, growth companies building themselves up. They do intend to have a much larger market value per share than they are showing in earnings. Yes, we do get companies with a negative PE, and just stating there that these companies, they will never make this information public, but if a company is losing money, they're losing money, so that's why you can get negative earnings. I surely do believe that you have to do this measurement backdated over a few years. And on our second valuation tool here, I'll usually look at the return on equity as well. Just to show you, the return on equity basically is the amount of net income returned as a percentage of its shareholders' equity. Here we want to know how the company uses our investment and do they actually get an income from that? How much income does the company generate using our money as investors? This is the type of questions you want to ask yourself. Using this multiple, in a formula, you can use the net income for that year divided by the shareholders' equity to get a clear picture of is the company making money from our investments. And then after that, we would look at the next multiple, our dividend yield, also very important. It's a financial ratio that indicates how much money the company pays out in dividends to each relative to its share price. I do believe companies pay a high dividend to their shareholders. It can indicate a variety of things about the company, such as the company might currently be undervalued, or that is if the company is attempting maybe to attract investors. On the other hand, if the company do not pay dividends or little dividends, it may indicate that the company is maybe overvalued, or if the company is maybe attempting to grow its capital. Thereby, we can say that certain companies, in particular industries, when they are well-established and steady earning, often have good dividend yields, even though they are not undervalued. Sectors to maybe look at this as your banks and utility stocks, they often fall into this category. In a formulation, you can use it as your annual dividends per share divided by your per share price at that stage in the market. Okay, our next one is actually quite a good one that I like to use in my portfolio as well, is adding growth stocks to my portfolio. A growth stock is a share, as I said earlier, in a company which the earnings are expected to grow at an above average rate relative to that on markets. Are they risky? A bit, yes, because many small cap companies are considered to be a part of this category. And yes, they do have a high PE, and mostly they are seen as overvalued by the market at certain stages. Taking into account, here you can see that I've brought it back to two steps, that you've got it when looking at all of these valuations. You've got to take into account, bring it back to two steps. Deciding when to build up a profitable portfolio, you've got to draw up a rough list of the shares that meets your basic criteria to some of the stuff that I just mentioned. Pull it up and get a basic criteria of what you want from your investments, and then further to do a more in-depth analysis about this. I've put it there on the right-hand side, our PSG fundamental research tools that you can use that's on the website available to you as clients, and please go visit there and find out more in-depth knowledge and fundamental analysis on the stocks you're invested in. To finalize on our last part, when you built up and invested your money into your portfolio, the key thing to do here is to maintain and review your portfolio. Firstly, I'd like to say at this point in time, you've made your investment and it's time to let it grow. guys, do not try to sell your shares in the first year since your initial investment, because with the small amount of growth that you can earn, or the growth that you can earn, if you sell, bring into consideration that there is going to be fees on it, so that's going to eat into your returns at the end of the day. A mindset, if you want to withdraw money from your account, if you really need to at that stage, just take it back and think about, what's the initial purpose of my investment with this equity portfolio? What do I want to do? Do I want it to grow over a 5-year period? Do I want short-term gains? Back to, are we conservative? Are we more aggressive? I'd like to think of an equity portfolio as a place that you can think long-term. Yes, the market is going to fluctuate, but think about that. What am I going to invest to this money, and how much can I afford to invest into this equity portfolio, like say for a period of over 5 years? Moving on. The next point that's very important as well is diversification. Remember guys, the market does fluctuate and forever will continue to. Therefore, we need to diversify our portfolios to minimize our risk and by spreading out our money around a number of shares. Therefore, I usually think about when I build up a portfolio for me, it's usually between 8 to 15 shares per portfolio, because the thing is, you can over diversify as well. So there's a key point. And then to conclude our webinar this afternoon on the last page here, I'd like to say a key point is for me is of the whole webinars, the most important factor is maintenance of your portfolio. Remember not to review too often. Remember as well, key again, the market do fluctuate. I believe as well, checking your portfolio at least once or twice per year is a good objective. But please make sure again, do in-depth research of it. And then another point that I feel investors do not do actually in the market is reading the SENS announcement, your security exchange news service. This is where all the latest news comes out from companies, results, board changes, etc. You can find this on our website as well, and like I say, on MoneyWeb. And then it's got to account for taxes, like say with the new with the latest budget, your withholding taxes up from 15% to 20%. It's going to play a factor in how you build your portfolio and what type of shares you're going to be invested in. And there, second to last, read up on our fees and transaction costs. Guys, this is very important because it can eat into your returns. And lastly, be aware that not all ordinary shares pay dividends. Be sure that you have the mindset, if you want to go into a long-term portfolio, that you want to be invested into shares that pay dividends. And I've done so over a period of time. So, I think for today, for my first webinar, that's me. And we're going to move on now to questions. If you guys would like to ask me something now, we can do that. Okay, Gerrit, Jonas. Let's see here. Okay, yes, I'm going to answer here, Johannes Eistek. Resources sector, the question is the resources sector the same as the basic materials? And yes, indeed, that is true, Johannes. Let's move on here to the next one. Okay, key point. Okay, Cassandra De Lima asked, what are the key points I look for when reading SENS announcements? It's based on, okay, firstly, you got to look at the SENS announcements that's applicable to your portfolio. And then within that, you also get much larger topic areas that covers the sectors that you are invested in. So with me also, that at first hand, I've got a glance at that. It's news from board changes, acquisitions of the company, disposals, loans, their results, trading statements, all these types of things are very important to see on the SENS announcements. And then let's pick another one here. Let's just go on. Okay, and then just Stuart Campbell, the PDF on the website. If you go and not log in, but if you just go to the website and you go onto your stock broking and local shares, there on the right-hand side on the drop-down list, you'll find a link to the research platform, and that's where I got this PDF of the tools to of how to use research as a tool. And then Tebow Harris, what are the chances of losing when you are an aggressive investor? Always a chance, but I'd rather be in the market than sit on my hands most of the time. I preferably believe that the market fluctuates. You got to sit it through. Shares do fluctuate, they go up and down, but never going to know when you're not in the market, eh? And then we will be sending, and then Soboto Modise, where can I get a copy of the slides? We will be sending it out as a PDF to all of you. And I believe, yeah, guys, any other questions, please pop me an email. I'll just go on to the next slide here, and I'll show you my email address, and you can just pop me an email. I can get into more depth on answering your questions. Let me just get to that. Just check here. Okay, there, guys, my name's, as I said, Karel de Waal. I'm a junior equity trader on dealing desk. And then my email address there is karel.deval@psg.co.za. And my direct telephone number as well. So please give me a call. And I think that concludes our webinar for the day. Thank you very much for attending, everyone. And have a good afternoon. Cheers, guys.